Coming up next on Gardener's Hotline, it's succulents and cacti. Hurry back. Welcome back to another season of Gardener's Hotline. I'm your host, Karen Stauderman, a University of Florida Extension agent. We've got some great shows lined up this season with new guests and some familiar faces. Today's show is about succulents and cacti. Now, succulents are not to be confused with cactus, and cacti are succulents, but not all succulents are cacti. Make sense? Well, succulents are plants that have some parts that are thick and fleshy, and this is how the plant holds water in arid climates or dry soil conditions. These plants thrive on little water, which makes them better adapted to survive under drought conditions. Well, meet Carrie Byram. She's the assistant director of Harry P. Lou Gardens in Orlando, Florida, and she has a passion for succulents. Welcome to the show, Carrie.
My pleasure, Karen. Good to see you.
Oh, Carrie, how did you get started in all these succulents?
Well, I've been very fortunate. I'm from Iowa originally, and I worked in a greenhouse in college, and we had a cactus and succulent greenhouse. And I love the colors and textures that are available in these plants.
Well, I can't wait to learn about the tricks of the trade for this, but first, let's invite our viewers at home to join us in today's program. The number to call in is 1-800-901-9238. So let's begin with talking about cacti.
Okay. Well, one of my tricks that I learned very early is that when you're dealing with cacti like this one here, one of the things I like to do is use newspaper or a bunch of napkins grouped together like this to really hold on to them well for when you need to repot. It makes it a lot easier to move them, and you can put them in any container or transplant them as you need without getting all those spines in you. And as it inevitably does, duct tape is your best friend in that situation. Yeah.
Have some on hand.
Yes, yes.
Now, Carrie, have you ever accidentally or broken some spines off cacti? Does it really damage it that much? Do you end up seeing any darkening on the cactus? For instance, you have a cacti up front here. If you ever broke the spines off, will that show?
No, not really. The spines are actually modified leaves. You're really looking at that fleshy tissue is what you're seeing there. So it's fine. And you know, people ask, what's the difference between a cactus and a succulent? You were talking about that. You know a cactus when you see a cactus. It's got those spines right there. Whereas the succulents that you see here, you can touch them, you can feel them. Some of them are even soft. They're not going to leave you running for the duct tape.
Well, let's talk about where we would get our cacti. Talk to me a little bit about where Lou Gardens gets their cacti.
Well, we have some great growers here in Florida, and some of them, especially one of my favorites is Florida Cactus that you're seeing here, and they have an amazing selection. They're one of the few places that is both a wholesale grower, but also will sell retail to folks. So you can go there and explore and really pick out those really weird and unique selections that you're looking for.
It's like a shopping store, a produce store.
Oh, yes.
Like a kid in a candy store.
You could say that. And there's all different sizes and containers. You can see they're constantly potting up new plants. They'll have both individuals, and then they'll mix some together for some ready-to-go containers.
Oh, some nice arrangements.
Yes, really beautiful containers.
Now, often, more times than not, people end up getting some of the cacti, and they die as quickly as they get home. Is there, do they also give you instructions on how to maintain this if you're going to keep them in your apartment or your house?
Well, I think the key is picking out the right succulents or cactus for indoors. We're gonna look at some here tonight that are really beautiful and the best colors and textures, but if you put them inside, they start to stretch out over time because they need more light. So by selecting the right ones for interiors, you can avoid some of those problems.
Now, I notice in the video, people would expect to see straight sugar sand, but it's not.
Correct. One of the things that I tell people is use regular potting soil.
That looks just like regular potting
soil. It is, and there's always that succulent and cactus forget about it. It's twice as expensive, and you really just need this regular potting soil. It's nice and light and airy. If you think about it on the other side, you think sand, but sand is so heavy, and you're trying to really have good drainage and those kinds of things. Another thing I like to add occasionally, this product here is called Turfus. And it's little clay shards. It's essentially the same thing that's in cheap kitty litter.
Okay.
So you could use that too. And it keeps the soil really nice and light and airy and well drained.
So you incorporate it in there?
Yes, or? You okay. can. And especially if you're even going to put them in the ground in your yard, you can add some of that to it and it'll really keep it nice and light.
Now I know it's one of the tricks is also to add a little beach sand on top. So it looks like the pot's filled with sand, but it's really not. It's just
absolutely.
To make it
a little top dressing. Yes.
And you can get these at any big box store. Right?
Absolutely. You can use sand, or sometimes I like to use pebbles, and you know, from a pet store,
right.
The aquarium section has all these beautiful colors. That's what I like to use. A little top dressing helps keep the water from splashing up soil onto your plants and those kinds of things. It gives it a really polished look.
Wow. Okay, well, talk to me a little bit about succulents now.
Okay. Well, if you look at some of the ones that we have here, there are all different colors and textures.
Oh, yes.
And you can see some of these. And what I like about them is this purple one on its own looks nice, but when you put this yellow one up against it, they both stand out even more for that.
Pops.
Yes, wow. Absolutely. And we forget that we tend to think of cactus and succulents as being very slow growing. You know, you think of that saguaro cactus
yes.
that's 200 years old
right,
and those things.
Right.
But these will actually grow fairly quickly. In a pot on its own, in 3 or 4 months, it'll be ready for a larger container.
Okay. Now, let's take a look about how you go about picking up your succulents out of the nursery.
Sure. One of the things that's neat is you can go somewhere like Florida Cactus that has them, but we're finding succulents and cacti all over the place now. You know, whether it's the grocery store, the hardware store, the big box store, succulents are becoming really popular, and they're used for all kinds of craft projects and those kinds of things. So they're very plentiful in supply.
Are they trendy? Is it a trend that's going to come
and go? Absolutely. They are trendy right now. Whether it's wedding bouquets that have succulents in them or little jewelry boxes with succulents overflowing. If you get on Pinterest or one of those craft sites, you can't help but come across some succulent projects.
Now, what do you look for when you pick out a succulent? What are some of the characteristics?
When I'm looking for succulents, one of the things I do is make sure that the leaves are nice and firm.
Okay.
That shows that they have enough water in them. And you also want them to be nice and compact. Kind of like we were talking about, if they're not getting enough light, they stretch out and they lose that nice, tight shape that you're looking for.
Okay, and then do you also look for perhaps any rotting or any insects, or are there any pests for them?
There really aren't too many pests. If you see any rotting, I would avoid those. You really want to keep a plant that's nice and healthy and looks really good from the get-go there.
We have a caller today, Cody from New Smyrna Beach. Hi, Cody. Welcome to the program. What's your question for Carrie today? Hi, Cody.
What I know is the strawberry pincushion. I'm pretty sure it's a tech. I don't know the technical name for it. It's just know what it's called. It gets a little pink fruit on it. I was curious how long it takes for that to grow back.
It's going to depend a lot on the time of year. During the summer months, it's going to grow a lot more quickly just because everything is. The dry weather, though, is actually really good for our succulents. So during the cooler season, make sure to check your plants to make sure they still have enough moisture. One of the ways that I do that is if you feel the leaves of your plants, when they have plenty of water in them, they're nice and stiff. When they need to be watered and you squeeze them, they have a little bit of a squish factor to it. And that's how you know that it needs more water. So the proper watering in those things will help get it to flower again more quickly.
We've got Barbara from New Smyrna Beach. These are good questions. Hi, Barbara. Welcome to the program. What's your question for Carrie? Hi, Barbara. Are you there? Well, we don't have Barbara just yet. Hopefully, she'll come to the phone or maybe... Okay. Oh, have we got her? Okay. Well, you know, you bring up a good question. How often... He mentioned... the earlier caller mentioned about its flowering. How often? Can it bloom twice a year, once a year?
Most of these will actually bloom during the winter months. And they'll be their most colorful during the winter months. A really good example of that is going to be this flapjacks plant. It's very common now. It's one of the most readily available. And it blushes this red color during the winter months. During the summer, it's a green. So you really see a lot of these at their best during the winter months.
Now, is this also an outdoor cactus or this indoor?
This is going to be outdoor.
Okay. Mm-hmm. We've got Carol from Orlando on the phone. Hi, Carol. Welcome to the program. What's your question? I don't hear her yet. Okay. Well, we must have lost her. So anyway, you have also some various different textures here. Now,
yes.
I know this is beautiful striped one. And this one, you know, cactus not only has a great, you know, different diversity, but I love the different colors and the textures. Talk a little bit about
this one. This is one of my favorites. This one's called the Zebra Haworthia, and it's great for indoors. It keeps this nice color and texture indoors, needs very low light levels. An office is a great place for this one, which is really nice to have. So this is one that I like to use, like I said, indoors. And you'll notice it's hard to describe here, but these white lines are actually raised and elevated. Oh. So it has this great texture to it too. And this is about the full size of it. Because sometimes, especially when we're using plants in things like these terrariums, we don't want them to get huge. We
right.
want them to stay small. And this is a really good one for that kind of project.
Right. We've got Barbara back on the line. Hi, Barbara. I hope we have you this time.
Hi, everybody.
Hi, what's your question?
Well, I have a Venus flytrap plant, and I'm wondering if that's part of the cacti family.
Good question. It is not. The flytrap is going to have some different needs than these succulents. It's going to need a lot more water, but you bring up a good point. When we're talking about succulents and mixing them in containers, we want to make sure that we're putting plants with similar water needs together, because otherwise your Venus flytrap isn't going to get enough water, or your succulent's going to get too much, and one of the two is probably going to die. So keep those carnivorous plants like your Venus flytrap either alone or with similar plants, and it'll do a lot better.
Oh, we've got Nancy from Palm Coast. Nancy, I'm going to get this call before we get started on a demo. What's your question today, Nancy?
Hi, my name is Rose.
Okay, Rose, okay. Hi, Rose. What's your question today?
I have a question. I just happened to turn this on, and I have a question. Do they have any type of cactus that they recommend planting in the yard to discourage other critters from running through the yard?
Good question.
Good question. And it's funny, in some parts of the world, they'll actually use cactus as fence posts and fence lines because it keeps people and critters out. You'd really want to go for some of the tall, very sharply spined cactus for that. Some of those in the Ceris group would be really good for keeping people and pets and everything out of your yard.
Okay. Well, let's get started on this nice little
yes.
demonstration we have here.
Well, when we talk about using succulents indoor, like I said, we want to make sure we're using the right ones. And here's an example of a terrarium that's so easy to make. All we're using here is this trifle dish. People use them for desserts, for the layered desserts. And we're kind of going to go for the same look.
Now, Carrie, there's no hole in this, so I want to remind people that there's no drainage on the outside.
Exactly. Drainage is key for succulents, so we have to be extremely careful. We're not going to put this outside because a 4-inch rain would really just flood this thing.
Yes.
So we're just going to water a little bit at a time. But all I'm going to do is use the potting soil and kind of push it down and just layer in the sand and other layers of potting soil in here to give it that layered look.
Carrie, can we also use colored sand? We see colored
you
sand
could.
In craft stores.
You could use colored sand. One of the things I see is that people want to use a lot of rocks. Well, one point is the roots on the side. That'll give the illusion of having a layer of rocks, but still keep your succulents growing. So you can put in a little pocket there, but just have it on the side.
And it's beginning to show
so that you can see it there. And then as the other layers form around it, you'll get that look without being detrimental to the health of your plants.
I want to tell the viewers at home, we have a new Facebook page, Gardener's Hotline Facebook page. So if you guys do crafts like this, please send them in on our Facebook page. We'd love to share
Absolutely.
Them with the viewers. And I'd love to see your talents out there.
Yes. So the plants that I'm going to use for a terrarium that's going to be inside, we mentioned this Zebra Haworthia here. This is going to be a really good one.
And then how deep do you plant these cacti?
Good question. When I pull this out of the pot, you can see it's got this nice, white, healthy root system. I'm going to put it right at the top, right at the same level there. I make sure to leave a little bit of a dip, like you can see here, so that when you water it, the water can soak in instead of just running off.
Right.
And that's really, really important. So we're going to keep
some good tablecloths. You know?
Exactly. We're going to keep building up those layers until we have a finished look. And then I like to put rocks or pebbles along the top there.
Now, how do you know which plants that go together? I know we have spillers, thrillers, and fillers.
Sure.
And you have standard plants. Tell me a little bit about cacti. Are there any rules?
There really aren't any rules. We have all different types. You can see this is a little sedum here, and it's going to trail over as it gets going. But we also have one of my favorite groups are kind of these, what I call the rosettes.
Oh, yes.
And there's just these beautiful colors and textures that are available for the rosette. So I like to put a lot of those together because it really kind of amplifies the colors and the textures.
We've got Billy from Samsula. Hi, Billy. Welcome to the program. What's your question today?
How are you ladies doing tonight?
Oh, fine, thanks. Thanks for calling in.
Yeah, I got this fungus all over the cactuses out in the yard, and it's killing them.
Oh.
Okay. What is... We don't see a lot with fungus usually, but sometimes we have some pests that will kind of look like a fungus or kind of like mold, and that's usually mealybugs. It looks like little white pieces of cotton stuck along the plant. That's generally an indication of water troubles, and it's too much water or too little. This
right.
time of year, it's probably, or during a rainy season, it's probably too much water.
Right. And make sure the irrigation doesn't hit the plants or
exactly.
come near it. That's another thing. I've seen that in the landscape.
Yes, and it'll leave some spotting on leaves occasionally. You're not going to do much about the rain, but you can control your irrigation. If you have those mealybugs, one thing that you can do is just use rubbing alcohol on a Q-tip or a cotton ball if it's not too big. Just touch it to them, and that'll clear up those little spot problems.
Right. Making sure you wear gloves so the spines don't get you.
Yes, yes, absolutely.
And while you're feeling that, we've got Nancy on the line. Hi, Nancy. Welcome to the program. What's your question for Carrie today?
I'm from Palm Coast. We live directly oceanfront. And I wanted to know, what are the best succulents when you live directly on the ocean?
Great question. Most of these succulents are very salt tolerant, so they'll do well in that scenario. Right here, you can see this is actually a dwarf aloe.
Okay.
And the aloes will do very well in that scenario. We also have some different agaves, and there's lots of different colors and textures of those. This is an agave that has a unique texture. We think of those big, bold leaves with the spines. This one is more like little pencils here, so it gives you that more fine texture.
How big will this get?
This will only get about 18 inches tall.
Oh, okay.
So it stays small. It's not the 4 foot tall and wide, the big one. So I would look at those agaves and the aloes and some of those sedums for your areas where you might get some salt spray.
Those are good ideas. Those are great ideas. Oh, and take a look at the rooster down here. This rooster is a great example of what we can use with some garden art. I just love that. We've got another caller on the line. Hi, caller. Welcome to the program. What's your question? Did we lose the caller? Caller, are you there?
This is Jenny.
Hi, Jenny. Go ahead with your question for Carrie.
Thank you. I'm wondering if you could recommend a reference book that would help us identify the different varieties of succulents that will grow in Florida.
Well, that... You bring up a good point there. There's a lot of great books on succulents, but they're not all necessarily on growing in Florida. That's where it gets tricky. Most of the succulent books are people from the West Coast who have these really dry climates. In my experience, the ones that you want to avoid are going to be the aeoniums. They're not going to last very long. And I'll tell you, I still get one every year, and it just... It dies, but I feel like this is going to be the year I'll make it through with
support
it.
Support the industry.
Yes. So the aeoniums would be one to avoid, and also hens and chicks is going to be another one. And if you're from other parts of the country,
I'm
from the Midwest, and we had hens and chicks, and it was what I call a pass-along plant because they're so easy to share, but they just won't survive the heat and humidity here in Florida.
Yeah. Well, let's take a look at what we've got going here, too.
Yes.
Now, this one we can kind of see what
will happen. I'll slide this over, we talked about the rooster there, and that's an example of a little topiary. And all that we're going to do with these is use sphagnum moss, and this is the long stringy moss. And you hear, here you can see the frame. It's a really simple box frame, and this is kind of what I'd call one of those Pinterest projects.
Yes.
You'll see a lot of picture frames and those kinds of things. And it's It's got the wire hanger on the back. So the wire is in there. When you peel it off, you're going to want to wet your sphagnum moss and stuff it as tight as you can inside here. That's basically going to be our planting medium for the succulents.
While you're doing that, we've got Madeline from Orlando. Hi, Madeline. Welcome to the program. What's your question? Is Madeline on the line? Oh, she left. We're having a tough time with Madeline today, but that's all right.
Okay.
So you're just using a pencil here and making
a probe. Yes, very fancy tools here, like pens and pencils. Chopsticks would also work well.
Oh, good idea.
But basically, this tool is just making a hole in your sphagnum moss. The sphagnum's packed really, really tight, and so the pen or chopstick makes a hole in there and allows you to put your little cuttings right in there. The sphagnum then swells in, and it'll hold those cuttings right in there. And they'll root fairly quickly.
How often do you have to water that?
I would water it every 2 weeks.
Okay, water from below, not from above?
What I usually do is, you can see we have a picture hanger on this.
Yeah.
I take it down, lay it flat, soak it, let it sit there for 10 minutes or so, and then hang it back up again.
Oh, wow. Mm-hmm. But that can get heavy.
Yeah, this one's not too bad. That's why the smaller sizes are a little bit better.
Okay.
And you can see, it doesn't take very long. For the plants, I'm just using these little cuttings here. And these are little plants that I had, and they were just some overgrown ones, so I just stick them right in there.
Now, do you guys have this stuff at Lou Gardens? What kind
of ideas? We have some, yeah. We have a lot of agaves and those kinds of things. We're working on the succulents.
What about hanging baskets? Do you have hanging baskets with a lot of succulents in them?
We have a few, and hanging baskets are a great way to use succulents because they don't require being watered every day. Hanging baskets
great.
Are such a love of
labor
there. Yeah, so you can use some succulents and really decrease the amount of work that you have.
Do you get wildlife attraction to any of these succulents, or not as much as flowering ones?
Not as much as flowering ones. There's some that are bat pollinated, the ones that flower at night.
Oh, like, so you've got one right here.
Yes.
This flower.
This one down
huge.
Here is called a carrion flower.
Can the camera
flower.
Follow me on this one? And here is what it looks like when it's closed.
And it's this big kind of hairy flower. It's actually called the carrion flower because it smells bad.
Oh man.
We can't smell it here too much.
What's
it but
smell
when
like?
I, well, carrion is decaying meat, so
oh, okay.
it smells like that. So it's actually fly and bat pollinated, so it'll have flies around it throughout the day. But it's got these crazy beautiful flowers and kind of those balloon type blooms that will open. Yeah.
You have to, because the camera on this, this is just amazing, and there's separate little.
And this is one that'll do really well planted in the ground. So you could almost use it like a ground cover if you want.
Now, are any of these, how about your pets, your cats and dogs? Do they rub against them? Are they attracted to any of them? Or are they?
They won't really be attracted to them, but one thing you do want to be mindful of is the leaves on these are kind of brittle. You can see here, you just kind of have to do this. I know we have a little dog who likes to get into trouble, and so if he rubs by one of these, it'll pop off some of the leaves.
Okay.
So you want to kind of put them in protected spots. But the nice thing about this is these plants are really easy to propagate. And so you can take the little leaflets that your dog knocks off, and over time, they will start to form little baby plants.
Oh, look at that, and the small roots under here? Wow.
Right on the edge there.
Now, how long did this take?
Again, depending on the time of year, this will probably be 3 or 4 weeks.
Okay.
And so one thing.
But those leaves feel wilty. Is that a sign that it's now the carbohydrates have left the leaf and gone into the plantlet? Because definitely I would have thought this would be dead because it's so limp.
Right.
Compared to these, you know, these crunchy
crisp
ones.
I think it's just a sign that it needs some water.
Okay.
So a little bit of water would be fine. So all we can do is take these little leaflets and just set them right on the surface of the soil. And I teach classes on succulents, and everybody takes their leaflets, and they just want to stick them in like that. Avoid the urge. Just set them on the top of the soil, and the plants actually have a gravitropism, so they can find, they know which way is down, and they'll send their roots down.
Well, what happens? Does it rot when you stick them in there?
It's more likely to rot.
Now,
you stick it in.
Do you do classes at Lou Gardens?
We do.
Succulents. So the general public can come and sign up for them.
Sure. We'd love
to
see them. And the propagation is one of the things that makes these so great because it's so easy to take those little leaflets off. Or sometimes you can take an overgrown plant, like you can see this one here.
What's the name of that one, by the way?
I call it Purple Edge because it's got these purple edges
faint.
To this side there.
Yeah, really small.
So you can take a cutting if you have an overgrown plant. What I do is take off a few of those leaves, and I can put these in the soil again. And you can simply stick that right into some soil.
So the stem goes in. Do you have to wait 24 hours to superize it before you stick it in?
Great question. You can, and that's what I did for the ones where we were doing our picture frame. But if you don't, it's fine. If you put it in dry soil, it'll be okay.
So you don't need to bleach ahead of time or any root tone?
No, no rooting hormone or anything. That it makes propagating succulents very easy.
You know, these are great holiday gifts. So
absolutely.
If you want to get some holiday gifts, these are inexpensive. You can make them at home. And, you know, everybody loves to have living things. And I don't see a lot of allergies on any of these. Am I right?
Is correct. There, there's no pollen
on
these. Yeah.
And for the younger generation, I know the millennial generation, the younger ones, they love this stuff.
It's amazing to see how people are using succulents. One of the nice things is they don't have a huge root system on them. So you can use them in about anything. I've seen people use old colanders for draining things.
Yeah.
It has good drainage built in, and that's a great kind of easy gift to share with someone.
You know, I've also seen in the trends is they're starting to use succulents in wedding bouquets, along with some beautiful Florida cut foliage. Our leather leaf goes great with these, you guys. But those are great ideas. You can
fantastic.
Get them from your own garden. You save on money.
Yes, and I was actually in a girlfriend's wedding, and my bouquet had some succulents in it, and I was able to cut them off and then grow them afterwards because they're so easy to grow from
cuttings. What a great memory. Then she can get back that as an anniversary gift, and, or the plant will last longer than the marriage. Oh, no, I shouldn't say that.
Yeah.
Oops. Now we've got some different kinds. Show me a little bit more different kinds of varieties.
Sure.
Here. I know you've got some of this purple one down here. What is
yes,
that one called?
This one's Pearl von Nuremberg. And this is one of the kind of Florida standard ones. That is a good one. It gets really tall, as you can see. It'll get probably 12 inches across, and it just keeps that purple color all year.
Now, do we want to keep these pot-bound, or do we want to put them in larger pots?
It's up to you. You can see we have a wide variety of different container sizes here, from this little one to a much larger. They will grow to their container size.
Okay.
But you might see after a while they'll start to get a little top heavy. This little one here, because of the growth of it, will start to tip over a little bit. So you can do two things. You could repot it into a bigger container, or you could snap it off and pot it this one again in another and keep growing them.
That's perfect. Mm-hmm. Well, we're at the end of our program, and I'd like to thank my guest, Carrie Byram, and for being here, and I want to thank all of you for tuning in. For more information on succulents or cacti, you can contact us and email us at wdsc@daytonastate.edu. Or you can like us on Gardener's Hotline Facebook page. So don't forget to visit us again next week on Gardener's Hotline.